More than 33,000 have been killed in Gaza. Meanwhile, significant developments on the battlefield. Tanks on the move as the Israeli military announced that it will withdraw its ground forces from southern Gaza. The remaining IDF troop presence is now tasked with holding the northern half of the strip. For Palestinians now returning to their homes, there is shock at the extent of the destruction, like here in Khan Younis.
Well, that footage certainly shows the surgical military operations and airstrikes that the Israeli military has been carrying out in Gaza. Obviously, I'm being sarcastic. And if you are at all relieved to hear that the IDF is withdrawing troops from the Gaza Strip, there's a major catch, which you're about to hear about from John Kirby.
It is really just about rest and refit for these troops that have been on the ground for 4 months, and not necessarily, that we can tell, indicative of some coming new operation for these troops. They've been on the ground for 4 months. The word we're getting is they're tired, they need to be refit.
The IDF troops are tired. They need a little bit of a break. They need to be refit. They need to stock up on their weaponry. And far right ministers Itamar Ben-Gvir and Bezalel Smotrich, I mean, they're even further right compared to Benjamin Netanyahu, are furious that the troops are withdrawing, obviously temporarily, in order to get some rest. They're furious with Netanyahu scaling back the troops in Gaza, even though, again, the IDF soldiers are going to go back to Gaza and continue their assault after they get the break that they so desperately need. Now, also keep in mind, there is one group of soldiers who will remain in Gaza, and that brigade has a couple thousand soldiers. So it's not a complete withdrawal, and of the troops that do withdraw, they will return to continue their military operations. Netanyahu is also salivating over the impending IDF assault on Rafah, despite President Joe Biden's demands that they not carry out those military operations, considering that there are more than a million displaced Palestinians in that tiny, tiny area of land. Rafah shelters some 1.4 million people, more than half of Gaza's population. The prospect of an offensive has raised global alarm. Nonetheless, though, Netanyahu has released a video today on X indicating that they have settled on a specific date to do their invasion into Rafah, although he didn't specify what that date was for the public.
They're having a real problem here in terms of figuring out what they're going to do in the Israeli cabinet. There's a couple of opposing forces. Benny Gantz is on the more moderate side of that cabinet, and he has in the past threatened that if they go into Rafah in the scale that Netanyahu wants, that he might withdraw from the cabinet. Now you got Smotrich and Ben-Gvir saying that they might withdraw from the cabinet if Netanyahu is not monstrous in killing enough Palestinians in Rafah. So now Netanyahu's in a bind. So now Biden could break the tie by saying, hey, listen, you guys aren't getting it. You're gonna lose your funding, etc. If you go into Rafah. When I said red line, I meant red line. And when I said consequences and ceasefire, I meant it, right? Now, of course, Biden didn't mean any of those things, and Netanyahu knows that. So that's why Netanyahu now comes up back and goes, no, no, no. You're misunderstanding what I'm saying. We're going into Rafah. I'm with the monsters, Smotrich and Ben-Gvir, and Biden can go walk, take a long walk off a short dock. I could care less what that loser thinks. Just like we told you he would say, and that's what he is saying. So we're gonna give you details on that, but already other cities have been leveled. As I told you in the earlier segment, 45,000 buildings destroyed in Khan Younis, which is in southern Gaza. Now Netanyahu's saying, hey, why don't they go back there? People have started to go back there. 55% of the buildings are destroyed. They're like, well, where are we supposed to stay?
Yeah.
I think the height of the humanitarian catastrophe in Gaza is still not quite understood by the world, as Netanyahu promises to do even more damage.
Well, let me attempt to help people understand if they're having difficulty understanding, because some Palestinians did try to go back to their homes in Khan Younis, and what they found was absolute devastation. So let's take a look at this footage as I explain what some of these Palestinians have experienced as they went back to Khan Younis. So IDF troops began their operations in Khan Younis back in December. But the Palestinians who have returned don't recognize the city because it's been leveled by the IDF. Okay, so buildings were either completely leveled or, as you can see in the footage, just very badly damaged. Paved roads have been bulldozed. Schools and hospitals are either destroyed or gone entirely. And so I want to give you some comments from the Palestinians who spoke to the Associated Press about what they experienced, including Mahmoud Abdel Ghani, who fled Khan Younis back in December, and he told the Associated Press the following. Many areas, especially the city center, have become unfit for life. I mean, we just saw the footage, it's obviously true. He also says, I found that my house and my neighbor's houses turned to rubble. Basel Abu Nasser, a Khan Younis resident who fled after an airstrike hit his home in January, said much of the city turned into rubble. There is no sense of life there, the 37-year-old father of two children said. They left nothing there. And so this is what Palestinians are dealing with. Even if the IDF completely withdraws from Gaza and they don't continue any military operations, there is nothing left in the Gaza Strip. There is no life left for the Palestinians to live. Their hospitals destroyed, their schools destroyed, refugee camps destroyed, homes, residential buildings destroyed. Water, infrastructure to get food and water to people destroyed. And I'm supposed to sit here and pretend as though the IDF did surgical strikes to take out Hamas specifically?
And by the way, a lot of people in the press do pretend that, and it is shocking.
Yeah, we don't do pretending here.
Yeah, and so look guys, to give you again more sense of the devastation, Ben-Gvir and Smotrich, who are in the cabinet as we explained, have said in essence that they are in favor of ethnic cleansing. They have talked about driving the Palestinians out of Gaza entirely and into the Sinai Desert where they'll be relocated. That's the definition of ethnic cleansing. And so it is not an accident that they've leveled all of Gaza. They want to make Gaza unlivable so that they can say, we were in the middle of a war, what could we do? We murdered tens of thousands of them, oh, by accident because Hamas made us do it. Plus, there's nothing to go back to. I guess like you gotta move them to another country. And this is beautiful waterfront property, as Jared Kushner said, in Gaza, it's now ours. And by the way, God told us a couple thousand years ago that it was ours, so that it's all good, we're all good. And Netanyahu is firmly on that side. He is not on the Benny Gantz side. And he's the one that has ordered all of the killings, all of the murder, all of the bombings and the death and destruction in Gaza. He's one of the biggest terrorists of my lifetime. If you think that they're not, that they really, you saw the footage. If you genuinely think that that was all targeting terrorists, then you think that the great majority of the Palestinians, 2.1 million Palestinians in Gaza are terrorists. You know what that makes you? An unbelievable racist, an unbelievable bigot, and a terrible person who says, I don't care, kill them, kill them, kill them. I bet they're all terrorists anyway. Destroy 55% of their buildings and then pretend you're hitting just terrorists. No one in their right mind believes that. And so Biden is pretending to believe it. What a joke he is. And here we go again with Netanyahu completely ignoring him and slapping him across the face.
Listen, I'm not entirely sure Biden knows what day it is or where he's at, what location he's at the very moment. So I'm just gonna put that out there. It seems like John Kirby has a lot more control over Biden's foreign policy than Biden does. Because Biden will say something and then John Kirby will hold a press conference where he immediately rebuts anything that Biden has to say, including Biden's alleged red line in regard to Israel invading Rafah. But I wanted to give you some updates on alleged peace negotiations because Egypt said that it is preparing to host a new round of talks aimed at reaching a ceasefire and a hostage deal. And the hostages absolutely should be returned. There should be no question about that. But there should be a permanent ceasefire, which is what Hamas is demanding. Now, Hamas leaders issued a statement saying they met with an Egyptian official in Cairo on Sunday and reiterated their position that no hostages will be freed until Israel agrees to a permanent ceasefire and removes all its troops from Gaza. But remember, Israel doesn't want a permanent ceasefire, especially Benjamin Netanyahu, who knows that the second the war is over, then he has to deal with political consequences, considering the Israeli people absolutely despise him and want to oust him from office. And they also don't agree to, you know, withdrawing Israeli troops from the Gaza Strip permanently. They think that the Gaza Strip now needs to be permanently occupied in order to maintain security. Netanyahu, at the start of his weekly cabinet meeting, said Hamas's extreme demands were the obstacle. Apparently, it's an extreme demand to have a permanent ceasefire in place.
Yeah, so let me explain that. When the media and Joe Biden, if you remember, he was eating the ice cream. He was on Seth Meyers' show and he was talking about, oh yeah, ceasefire coming up on Monday. And I told you, oh, that's because the Michigan primary is about to happen. There is no ceasefire. He's lying. Guess who was right? That ceasefire never happened. Joe Biden was full of crap. He was just trying to trick you into getting your votes. So, what's the reality of the ceasefire? I said at the time, I don't get it. Why would Hamas agree to a ceasefire where they get basically a month off, which Israel wanted to rest their troops for a month anyway, and they decided that they're gonna go rest them now. They say, we are definitely invading Rafah, so our withdrawing of some troops here is just to get them some well-earned rest. I mean, they've been busy killing Palestinians. And you can work up a sweat. I mean, we have an enormous military. They have almost nothing. But to destroy all their buildings and to kill 33,000 people, that takes a lot of effort. So we're giving them a little bit of rest here, but we're gonna come back and kill the people in Rafah. So Hamas says, well, we'll agree to release the hostages if we have a real ceasefire and this war is over, permanent ceasefire. Okay, then that makes sense. But if I give you all the hostages now and you take a month long vacation and come back and obliterate Rafah, well, I have no leverage left. Now, I might hate Hamas and you might hate Hamas, but you have to see, hey, when I'm negotiating, who's on the other side and what's their incentives and disincentives? And Hamas is saying, if I give you all these guys, Netanyahu is saying he's gonna murder all of us anyway. Hamas and the Palestinian civilians. So why the hell would I give you the hostages? Now I want the hostages back. Here, for all the idiots who say, have you demanded that Hamas return them? I demand it. Did that work? Come on, how can anybody be that dumb? You have to figure out, how do you get the hostages back? How? You can't say, oh yeah, give it to me. Like, I'll give you a lunch break ceasefire, and then I'm back to killing all of you, and I demand all the hostages. That's a preposterous demand. So of course you're not gonna get a ceasefire. So right now, this thing's a disaster. He's gonna go back into Rafah. And by the way, the million people are starving. And now more and more press reporting, yeah, the deaths have begun. We showed you some earlier. Now it's getting to be much more deaths in northern Gaza as people starve to death. So meanwhile, John Kirby is the Baghdad Bob of this war.
Yep.
Just going there going, oh yeah, I don't see any homicides. I don't see any killings. I don't see any genocide. I think Israel's great. And we can't wait to rush them more weapons. And Shep Biden's a loser. Nothing he said makes sense. He's a senile old fool. The official policy of the deep state is we support Israel no matter how many people they kill. Okay, that's what I thought, John.
The best way to see what the United States is thinking about this ongoing war is to just listen to what John Kirby has to say during his pressers. Just absolute disgraceful commentary and denial of the reality on the ground in Gaza. So it doesn't really matter what Biden has to say, right? I do think Biden wants to have his cake and eat it too. He sees that young voters that he so desperately needs, Muslim voters, Arab American voters that he so desperately needs, especially in swing states like Michigan, have turned their backs on Biden. So he, you know, provides some rhetoric to maybe alleviate their concerns. Obviously, it's not working because people weren't born yesterday and they see what's currently happening and what continues to happen in Gaza. But you know, the actions speak louder than words. When it comes to John Kirby, he's pretty open and honest about where the US stands on Israel and the IDF's assault on Palestinians in Gaza. And you know, Biden might lie to us and tell us what he thinks we want to hear, but what the government carries out is the antithesis of what Biden claims, right? So it's gonna keep going.
I have mainstream Democratic friends who watch TV. And they genuinely believe that Biden's words matter.
Well, they're suckers. Sorry to your friends.
So my point is, until Biden takes $1 that away from Israel that we were gonna send them, then I don't believe anything. Like, and Anna's right. You'd be a ridiculous sucker to believe, like, well, I mean, not only has he not taken a dollar away, he's rushed them several billion dollars already around Congress, and he wants to send him another $14 billion without a nickel off that number. Okay, you better give Israel the whole $14 billion. But here's nice words that I don't mean that never come to fruition, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Okay, if you're a total and utter sucker, you would believe that. But the rest of us care about action and numbers. Don't tell me that you're criticizing Israel and then say, I'm going to give them $14 billion more to do more of this. Anyone who's in favor of that aid package, Republican and Democrat, are monsters and genocide deniers and genocide enablers. Every single one of them, which is about 100% of the Republican Party and about 80% of the Democratic Party.
Thanks for watching the Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.